Last week, many of you probably heard or read about a fight which took place over here between two Hurricanes and two Messerschmitts. It was one of the most adventurous flights we've had reported, and it took place at over 20,000 feet and 30 miles on the German side of the lines. Well, tonight, I want to introduce to you the young New Zealand pilot who was mainly concerned in this fight. I can't tell you his name, but he's known in the squadron as Cobber, which is New Zealand for pal. And by that name, listeners to this program a few weeks ago may remember having heard our recording of him talking to us when actually in flight over the frontier. Well, since then, he's added a Messerschmitt to his bag of a couple of Dorniers, and he's been mentioned in dispatches. And now here he is to tell you about this, his latest affair with the Germans.
Well, the fight was during one of my patrols, and we'd been up for about an hour and a half, when I saw a burst of anti-aircraft fire ahead of me. There were two of us, and so I gave the order to the other pilot, a sergeant, to close up, and we went to have a look. About 5,000 feet above us, I saw some glints in the sun, and so I climbed up after them and recognized them as seven Heinkels. As we approached, they turned towards their own lines, and we gave chase. They put their noses down and started to go like stink, and we went after them. I was going flat out, and hardly dared take my eyes off them, except for an occasional glimpse to see if my other man was up. After about 3 minutes' chase, I gave a quick glance to my left to see if my sergeant was with me, and noticed a machine about 100 yards behind. I thought it was my sergeant, and I was just going to call on the wireless to close in, when I heard him yell, "Look up, something's on your tail." The machine, I presumed to be him, was their old friend, the Messerschmitt. The next thing I knew was whang, and I saw the tip of my wing disappearing into the blue. It had been hit by a shot from his cannon. I immediately did a steep turn to the right and saw the Hun had also turned and was climbing up for another attack. I managed to get in a short burst at him, and he dived down. At the same time, I was hit again from the rear by a second Messerschmitt, who I found out afterwards had already shot down my sergeant just after he'd yelled to me. Luckily, he got away with it and managed to make a landing on our side of the lines. Then started a general free-for-all, me chasing one and the other chasing me. It was when one of them climbed and flattened out of the top that I managed to get in a longish burst from behind and sent him down, giving out black smoke, and later he burst into flames. Meantime, the other had got behind me, and that was when he got my engine with another cannon shot, which made a big hole in it. Oil and fumes poured into the cockpit, and oil went all over the windscreen and instruments. The Messerschmitt went down under me. I saw him go by and stuck my nose down, hoping to get him in my sights. But as my engine had gone, my plane was too sluggish to get a quick sight. After that, I expected him to come back and teach me to play the harp. But either he thought he'd used up all his ammunition or thought I was finished, because he didn't make another attack. I was then about 30 miles on the wrong side of the lines. But with the help of a very strong wind blowing towards France at 20,000 feet, which is the height I was at, I managed to glide over French territory. Then the flames began to lick back from the engine and fumes almost suffocated me. So I opened the hood and undid my safety harness, preparing to jump. Then I looked down and saw my parachute strap off my shoulder. It had slipped, and so I got back again. Just after that, the flames went up, and I managed, after a long glide, to pull off a forced landing on the edge of an aerodrome. I clambered out of the cockpit and more or less passed out because of the fumes. Meantime, the French had arrived and taken me back to their sick quarters and gave me the once-over plus a lot of brandy. Later on, a French pilot had also been forced to land, heard that I was in there, and decided to celebrate with me. After that, I felt grand and was flown back to my station where, in the evening, we had another reunion.
Well, thank you very much, Cobber, and once again, congratulations. And I hope we'll be congratulating you again.